trading punches with the enemy. Ooh, I built myself a double thick stone tower, lies higher than the eye can see. Trapped in my flesh and bone, crying out to you, Lord. I'm desperate. Love pulled out of this cage and set me free. All of my fears, like Jericho walls, gotta come down, come down.
stand up together. Father, we want to thank you for this morning. We want to thank you for your presence that is in this room right now, Lord God. Thank you. Thank you, Father God, that you call us, that you invite us into your very presence, Lord. God, and we approach your throne with confidence, like your word says, because of what Jesus has accomplished on the cross. We come here to your throne, Father God. We approach you, God, with our hearts full of gratitude for what you've done and what you will continue to do, Jesus. You are a faithful God, Lord. I pray, God, that the songs that we sing this morning are much more than just lyrics on a screen, God, but that these would be declarations of our heart, Father. I pray for unity in this room, God, that we would have one heart as we worship the name of Jesus, as we honor you, Father, our faithful God, our forgiving God, the all-powerful and mighty God. We honor you, Father. Everything that we do today is about you, God. It's about the name of Jesus. We know that you are faithful, God. We humble ourselves before you, Jesus, so you can have your way in us. Holy Spirit, lead us in this time together. We love you, and we pray this in your name. Amen.
I won't forget the wonder of how you brought deliverance, the exodus of my heart. You found, you freed me, held back the waters from my release. Oh Yahweh, it's your blood.
Took me by the hand, and you marched me out in freedom.
By your grace that we are where we are, Father, both in our lives, God, and as a church, Lord Jesus. You've been faithful these 30 years, God, of ministry. You've been so good, God, so good. And Father, we celebrate you. Yes, we're celebrating 30 years of ministry, but we are celebrating you, Jesus. You have been faithful. You, God, you have made it for us, God. You made the way for us, Lord Jesus. Just thank you, Father.
this be a generation set apart from all of you? Will we be known for who we worship? We live for you. We live.
faithful for 30 years, 40 years, 50 years. Every year you are faithful, God. Every year you are faithful, God. I'm a testament of your glory, of your fire, of your life. You are a faithful God. Renew us today with your fire, God. Come in your glory, Lord. Come in your glory. Come in your glory, Lord. Light a fire. Light a fire, God. Let your fire burn. Let your fire burn, God. We need you. We need you, Jesus. We need you, Lord.
Sound rushing wind, fire of God, fall within. Holy Ghost, breathe on us, we pray.
As we repent, turn from sin, fire, ember, smoldering. Breath of God, fan us into flame. We need a fresh wind, the fragrance of heaven. Pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out. Oh, pour out your spirit, God. Come in your power and your glory, Lord.
Church, bear your light, lamp, flame, city bright, King and King, come is what we pray. 'Cause we need a fresh wind, the fragrance of heaven. Pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out. A holy anointing. Blowing, let all the redeemed cry. presence of heaven. Pour your spirit out. Pour your spirit out. A holy anointing, the power of your presence. Pour your spirit out. Pour your spirit out. Pour your spirit out. Pour your spirit out.
Fragancia del cielo, sopla Espíritu, sopla Espíritu, su unción se derrama con poder de lo alto, sopla Espíritu, sopla Espíritu, y sopla Espíritu. Sopla Espíritu,
sopla Espíritu,
sopla Espíritu. alcanza del cielo, sopla espíritu, sopla espíritu, su unción se derrama con poder de lo alto, sopla espíritu, sopla espíritu, sopla espíritu.
Te adoramos, Jesús.
I am waiting on you, my child. I am waiting on you to answer the call that I have placed before your life. This call has come from the heavenly host. It's come from the holy habitation that I live in, says the Lord. It comes from the very ground that I walk upon, the holy ground. My child, there is a wind that is about to start blowing like no other wind across this nation, across this country. This wind is a consuming fire that is in this wind, and I am calling you from the deep. I am calling the old, and I am calling the young. I am calling the old. You are going to leap like a deer. You are coming forth, my child. I need an army to be ready for the next phase, for the next wind that is coming. Can't you tell what is all about you? Haven't you seen the signs? My child, I am calling, I am designing, I am putting together an army of believers that are called. Can't you hear the call? Can't you hear my voice this morning, says the Lord? Can't you smell the fresh bread baking? My child, there is a wind like no other wind that is a consuming fire that is about to come, and I want you to be part of it. I want you to make room in your heart for compassion. I want you to make room for the lost, because I am sending them. So be ready, be prepared, thus says the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Pour your spirit out. Pour your spirit out.
Pour your spirit out.
Pour your spirit out.
Pour your spirit out.
Woo!
Pour your spirit out.
Pour your spirit out.
Spirit out, pour your spirit out.
Stronghold, shine through the shadows. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Oh, I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. There's no other name, Jesus. We speak Jesus, yes, to our family, to our bodies, to our health right now. Somebody could be healed in this moment. I declare Jesus, the name above every name that has the power to heal, deliver, set free, redeem, restore, renew, refresh. Thank you, Jesus, for the power of your name, the authority that's in your name. The sickness and sin have to bow, have to go in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. There's power in your name. There's healing in your name. There's peace in your name. There's victory in your name. So we worship you today. We celebrate you today. Hallelujah. We celebrate you, Jesus. We honor you and glorify you in this place. We thank you that you're still moving among us. You're still speaking to our hearts. Even after 30 years, you're still taking us somewhere because you saved the best for last. The glory of the latter house shall be greater than the glory of the former house. The latter rain and the former rain and the former rain and the latter rain falling all at the same time. Hallelujah. There will be, as you just spoke, through tongues and interpretation of tongues, there will be a great harvest that even now is coming in from the north, the south, the east, and the west. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready for the harvest. Hallelujah. Get ready for that harvest. Thank you, Father. We still, Lord, we're going to be a church that distracts you, Jesus, enough to get your attention. We'll distract you enough to get your attention. Hallelujah. And we thank you, Lord. We thank you for your faithfulness. We celebrate that faithfulness, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Well, I have to say the Lord bless everybody. You can be seated. Thank you, worship team, for taking us into the presence of the Lord. Now, I want to say just just a point of information. This is the first Sunday with our brand new sound system. We're still working on it, so please have mercy with us. We have some EQ things that we'll stay on top of and get all those little issues worked out. But thank you again for those of you that gave, and it's working, and we're blessed. And I think for the most part, it sounds great. I think it sounds great. We'll keep tweaking it and only make it better. But thank you again for being a part of that. If you're here today as a guest, and we've got several guests that I'm going to acknowledge in a moment, but if you're here today, this is your first time to worship with us here on our 30th anniversary here at Acts 2 Worship Center. If you're in this room or if you're online, and we know you're a part of us out there, and we thank you for being connected to us. If you're online or in this room, and this is your first time at Acts 2 Worship Center, could I see your hand for those in the room anyway? Let me see your hand. Anybody here for the first time? Yes, right over here, right over here. God bless you. Welcome. Anybody else that I missed? Right back there. God bless you, ma'am. Would you do something for me and I'll do it with you? Would you take your cell phone out if you have it with you? Take your cell phone in your hand real quick. Would you text the word welcome? There's an instruction you'll see on the screen. Even if you're at home and worshiping with us for the first time, text the word welcome to the number you see on the screen, 561-232-3992. That's all. The message is the word welcome. That's the number. It's going to come to my personal cell phone, and I'm going to receive that from you, and I would like to be able to receive that from you so that I can respond and reach out to you. I promise you nobody's going to come knocking on your door or anything like that. I just want to be able to reach back to you as the pastor, and it comes to me. We don't share it with
anyone else. It'll come right to my phone. So the word welcome to 561-232-3992. And if you're online, please do it as well. We want to reach to you and extend a personal greeting to you. But for all of you that are guests here today, thank you for being here on our 30th anniversary. And let's all welcome all of us and everybody and each other and all of that. We are blessed and honored. I want to make a couple of introductions for some special guests that are in the room. First of all, I want to have all of my family. We got quite a few of them. My mom and dad surprised us, and my youngest sister, they drove all the way down here from Alabama to be with us for our 30th anniversary. I want all of my family to stand. We'll just have them all stand. All of them. In-laws, outlaws, bylaws, all of that kind of stuff. We're so glad y'all are here celebrating this with us. I want to say a big special God bless you to Pastor Bill. Pastor Bill, words fail me. You know how my wife and I feel about you and Esther. We thank you for your heart, for your vision. There's a church here in this spot because of the vision of this man over 35 years ago. Pastor Bill, we honor you today. This is as much your celebration as ours. One of our churches are under our cover and under our leadership, we're the parent church to Wellspring Church. Most of this congregation know that. But Pastor Petrie, he's here with us at 11 for our service. Pastor Petrie, Wellspring Church, thank you for being here with us today. Former staff member and dear friend until Jesus comes is also here visiting us. Pastor Willie Reyes. Pastor Willie, God bless you. Thank you for being here with us today. And we're so glad for all of you that are celebrating with us today. Well, we're going to continue to worship. And it's as important a part of worship as anything else we do, is paying our tithe unto the Lord. Our ushers are ready. You don't have to move. They'll move among you and receive your tithe. If you're online, this is a great opportunity. With a couple of clicks, you can pay your tithe, and we're doing that all together. So God bless you right now as you tithe. There's an open window over my life in heaven somewhere. Out of that open window, you pour out blessing, provision, increase, because it's not ever just about me. It's always about others, being a blessing to others. So we thank you for that open window over this house and over the life of everyone who's tithing. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, let me give you a little instruction. Now, 9 o'clock crowd, they're invited to come back. But because the weather was really funny this morning, actually raining, it was wet and kind of strange, we're not going to try to serve and sit together here to eat. I don't know what it would look like by the time the service is over. Don't want to risk that because we don't have enough room under the portico chair for everybody. So if the weather had become bad, and it doesn't matter now, but what we're going to do is our lunches are going to be to-go. They are arriving in to-go boxes, individual meals catered by CR Chicks, delicious home-cooked food. And we're going to let you grab that on your way out and just take it home with you. We've even got 30th anniversary cake for dessert today. So you're going to get a lunch and a piece of cake, and we're going to send that out with you as you leave today. So please take that on your way out. Now, Brother Terry, I hope the people don't let me down. Don't let me down now, you that are online. Don't let me down. To have a good moment. 30th anniversary Sunday. Our district superintendent's going to be with us. We explained everything again, how to do it, and we're going to try again. And I hope we see this screen filled with our at-home worshipers here for our 30th anniversary. So if you are watching online, you're in our Zoom group, you received the text, didn't they, Pastor Jamil? Yep. They got the text, which is the Zoom link. Now, you don't click on it until right now. So if you're online, would you click on that Zoom link and Zoom into us, and let's see who we've got that's willing to let us see their pretty faces here on 30th anniversary. Let us see their pretty faces anniversary Sunday. Click on the link now. Here we go.
Click on the link now.
Please don't let me down.
Here it comes.
Here it comes.
We're going to try it one more time.
We're going to try it one more time.
We're going to try it one more time.
I'm waiting for Pastor Jamil. He hasn't hit the trigger back there. Something's about to happen. I believe it. I declare it by faith. Come on now. Come on now. There they are. There's the Mitchells. God bless you. Now, what I want you to do is everybody stand up and turn around. We don't want them to see the back of your head. Our camera's back there. Everybody stand, turn around, and then we see each other. Lester and Jennifer Mitchell, we love you. Thank you for clicking in with us. Here comes some more. Come on, they're coming. Here they come. Ingrid, you're there. Turn on that camera, Ingrid. Erica, turn that camera on real quick. Come on, everybody. There's Ingrid. Woohoo! Hey, Ingrid. We love you. Come on, Erica. You can do it.
Come on, Erica, you can do it.
Come on, people, come on, click that link. Here we go.
Come on, click that link. Here we go.
Come on, come on, come on.
Come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on.
Well, come on now.
Come on now.
Come on, folks.
Come on, folks.
Come on. Come on, anybody else, real quick.
Come on.
Click on the link and join us real quick right here.
Join us.
We want to see you today.
We want to see you today.
Just keep looking that way and they'll see your faces. I'm just looking up here to see if anybody else comes on the screen. We don't want to waste time. We just want to give you a chance. God bless you, Jennifer and Lester. Thank you, Ingrid. Erica, I think maybe you hear us. We don't see you, but thank you for clicking in. And I don't know, maybe you couldn't get your camera to come on for some reason. But anyway, God bless y'all. We know you're out there. And we are grateful for you that tried to link up so we could see you this morning. We're going to go ahead right here and just get ready to bring our offerings. Thank you so much for being faithful in your giving so that our missions partners and all that they do, they can continue to do through your giving and our faithfulness. I want to mention one other person. I'm sorry. We have one original member left with us, Pastor Terry. One. Now, we have one that's at home because she's in her upper years. That's Sweet Alma. That's Chuck and Sue Ann's aunt. She's had a surgery recently, and Alma couldn't be here, but she was just here a couple of Sundays ago because there ain't no stopping her. But I want to acknowledge somebody that I've mentioned. I told the story recently that the very first chairs that we had to sit in as a church when we were still meeting in the garage in a house was by Susan Karate. Susan, stand up. She's right here on the front row. Give them a wave. She's an original member from that original group of about 20 of us worshiping in a garage, Pastor Terry, when we started all those years ago. Thank you, Susan, for still loving us and staying with us, and we love you dearly. Well, let's stand, everybody, now. Let's stand. Father, we are grateful for the joy that it is to give, that you've blessed us that we can give. And Lord, you have even attached awesome promise to giving, that when we give, your favor rests upon us. When we give, you give back to us again, never to have more, but only to give more. Never to keep more, but only to give more, because need never increases around us. Need only increases. So, Father, meet the need of every one of our missionaries, wherever they are right now. Touch them, provide for them. Lord, let us do more than we've ever done before in this year of 2021, our 30th anniversary year, and we give you the glory for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I know we're a little bit crowded for COVID-19 standards, but still move around with your mask and greet one another in the name of the Lord.
God bless you all. Yeah. So we're here celebrating 30 years of service, 30 years of dedication, 30 years of doing the Lord's work. And we are grateful for that to our Pastor Calvin and Pastor Christy. So Pastor Calvin and Pastor Christy, would like you guys to come up here, please. Come on, let's show the appreciation. Let's show the appreciation. You know, when you think of, you know, the humility, and you think of the self-sacrifice, and you think of, you know, just putting the Lord's work first, putting people first, you know, it's just hard to explain and how much we really appreciate what Pastor Kelvin and Pastor Chrissy has done over the years. So as a token of our appreciation on behalf of Acts 2 Worship Center and all of the church family, we'd like to present you with a token here. And this is a all paid expense. We'd like to send you guys on a 5-day vacation. And this is a voucher that you can cash in. We'd like for you to cash it in within 90 days at least. And it's a 5-day vacation on behalf of a church family, just to show a small appreciation for what you have done over the years. Yeah. And Dr. Rayburn, can you come up, please? You can just pray a blessing over pastors and the church. Amen.
Would you extend your hands toward your pastors? Scripture says that our pastors are gifts from God to the local church. And Father, we are grateful for these faithful gifts. You bless this church abundantly and immensely with these gifts. We thank you for Pastor Calvin and Pastor Christie. Their faithfulness, their guidance of this portion of your body on earth to its health and success of this present day. We thank you for all they have done for you. Now, Lord, we pray that you would bless them, prosper them, meet their every need, and continue to use them to impact Southeast Florida, this area, this city, and your kingdom for your purpose. Lord, minister to them in every way. Whatever any need surfaces, Lord, take care of it and bless them beyond measure. And we thank you for doing it because we know you desire to do it for them. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Praise God.
Thank you all. Any words, Pastor? No?
I don't say a lot of words because I get emotional and, you know, and this is a very extra emotional day. I see your faces and I see the faces of many faces, many years flashing in front of me. Faithful people that have stood with us, George and Tina, they're pretty close to some of the originals. And we appreciate every one of you. Those who are watching online, we appreciate you. To our family, we got our doorbell rang last night, and it was my mother and father-in-law and sister-in-law, and that's such a blessing. Caitlin drove after work last night to be here. And Kyle and Giovanna and Cammy, all of you, and those who couldn't be here. I know my mother would love to have been here today, and we love you. We can say one thing about the summary of 30 years, and that is God is faithful. God is faithful. To Pastor Petri, you know, you're a few years behind us in starting. My word to you is God is faithful. He will walk you through every step. We have seen it. We have experienced it. And Debbie, your pretty close to original member, and I'm sorry I name anyone, Carmen, Robbie, all of you who, Dee, your whole family, I better stop or I'm going to get in trouble, because some of you, I see your faces, and you've been through with us for years, and just standing, it means more than we could ever say. We have one more original member who was not mentioned. That's our son, Brandon, who's at the sound, who does not like to be seen. But he was 2 years old when we started. And, you know, to my children, Amelia and Ashlyn, Amelia's not feeling well today. Ashlyn couldn't be here. But my children, I love you very much. You are my life. You know that. I can't start. Pastor Willie, you know me. I can't talk about my kids without crying. I love my children. Aaron's here somewhere. And thank you, kids, for staying with us all these years, for loving us. We love you all. God bless you. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you.
Good morning. I just want to say something quick. You know, they're talking about the originals on this church. Actually, my wife, Elsa, and I, we consider ourselves originals in the sense that we moved from New Jersey about 17 years ago, next month, actually, 17 years ago. And within a couple of weeks, I went to Pastor Bill's church in West Palm Beach. And, you know, we drove from here to there. It was like half an hour or something. And then at the end of the service, I introduced myself to Pastor Bill. And he says, you came too far. You have a church just a mile away from your house because we live right here, you know, in the corner. So he says, you came too far. So next week, we came here. Next week after that, we came here. And we've been here ever since, you know. I always tell people, you know, Elsa and I are not the type to be church hopping, you know, we're going everywhere. You know, we figure this is it, and we've been here 17 years. So we love Pastor Calvin and Pastor Christy, you know, the work they've done for all of us. And when we pray all the time for the sacrifices they're doing, and we love this place, and we love most of the people here. I know we have new guests, but we love everybody here. Yes. We love everybody. Well, some people I haven't met yet, but we love them all anyway. Okay. Thank you.
That's great. Thank you, George. Oh. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Andy. Thank you. Mom and Dad, thanks for surprising us. You know, it's always good to have you here. They were here. My parents were here in the very first service we had in this building, that very first Sunday, they were here. And please, those of you that saw the big banner, stop there. That's our history on that banner out there. You saw it coming in. Look at some of that. You'll say, oh, look at that. I remember that. Or, wow, what was that? We've got just 30 years of history in those photos that are in that banner there. But thank you. We love you. We're in this together. You know, I always say that. Thank you for the pastoral staff we have, for our leadership team have been serving with us so faithfully. I mean, we have such a spirit of unity like we've never known before. And we know what God says about unity. Where there is that unity, He commands the blessing. He commands the blessing. So thank you very much. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you. Well, we're going to be blessed by the word this morning. Pastor Terry is my pastor as an Assembly of God ordained minister in our fellowship. He's also the pastor of over 1,300 other pastors in our peninsula. Our district is made up of the peninsular part of Florida. This part of Florida is one big Assembly of God district, over 350, 400, something like that, churches. And we have known Terry so many, many, many years. And we've always loved and respected he and Athena. He'll tell you a little bit about that later. But we welcome you, Pastor Terry. God bless you as you come to minister the word of the Lord to us.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Laura. Praise the Lord. Aren't you glad for the love of the family? Amen. Their flesh family is here today, and we thank them for that great effort. We all have roots that go back to Alabama, And those are great moments, and it's just great to see them. But we also have family that is spirit, that is worldwide, and you are part of that family. And just what a great privilege and joy and thankful, wondrous blessing it is to be here with you this day. 30 years. Wow. And I know God is here because you still love one another. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, I have not had opportunity to be here very often, and that's a good thing. Because if I show up too often, that's a problem. And your pastors are fabulous, wonderful, anointed, and blessed leaders. Amen. Pastor Calvin and Pastor Christie are people of character. They are people of integrity. They are people of righteousness. And they have led you uprightly, transparently, and according to the Word of God. And that's why I have not had to be here very often. Thank you. It is a wonderful, wonderful joy to be here today. And I'm so grateful to see all of you. The Lord is marvelous. He constantly guides us and constantly touches us in His Word and by His power, and we are so thankful for that. You know, as I started preparing after Pastor called me a few months ago, and, you know, I've been doing this over 20 years, so I have a few sermons about the church. But I just didn't feel a release or a joy over any of those sermons. And the Lord led me to, and I wonder why He would do this, at Acts 2 Worship Center. But the Lord led me to Acts chapter 2. Some mysteries can only be known by God. But as I began to read that chapter with a new awareness of God's presence, I saw it in a different way. We all, and every theologian that's worth his theo, refers to the second chapter of Acts and the day of Pentecost as the record of the birth of the Christian church. And indeed, it was. God was transitioning from the old temple worship, where the blood of animals shed every year covered sin. He was transitioning from that to Jesus being the Lamb of God, slain but once for all the sins of all the world. And His blood did not cover our sins, it cleansed us from our sins. And the first 20% of Acts chapter 2 has to do with the birth of that miraculous church. Then Peter's sermon, about 50% of the chapter in the middle, lays out the strategy for what God was planning for the church. And usually, we Pentecostals kind of draw it to a conclusion at the end of Peter's sermon. But there are a couple of paragraphs at the end of chapter 2 that give us God's heart for the way a healthy Christian church ought to continue. So the miraculous, awesome birth of the church at the beginning of the chapter and the awesome and miraculous continuation of a Christian church, a spirit-filled Christian church, is recorded by Luke at the end of the chapter. And I want to echo a couple of things that Pastor Calvin said. It is a joy to be here with so many of you. I've said the family, I've known that name I was ordained in the Alabama district. It's been a while. I had black hair. Use your imagination. <You know? laughs> It was shoulder length, okay? It was the early 70s, right? All right. Fu Manchu mustache, anybody remember those? I had sideburns that were long. As a matter of fact, I had to cut holes for my arms to go through my sideburns. They were so long. And I knew of the Lyrilla family and their faithful service to God and leadership in that great district, and then met Calvin and Christy here when I was youth director, actually. And it was quickly obvious that God had a special ministry for them, and today is evidence of that. And Bill Ilniski, we worked together in Beirut, Lebanon, when we could get outdoors. There have been about 5 or 6 civil wars since we were there, but we had the honor of being there for the first one. And they did their best to shoot us, hallelujah. But God delivered us, and He has led our lives every day and every moment, and we are so grateful. These moments should not be moments for messages that just come out of the file, because there is something unique, precious, and absolutely fabulous about what God does to start a church and what He does to continue a church in health and power. That makes these milestones all the more special. You should have found Acts chapter 2 by now in your Bible or on your iPhone or iPad or those other instruments that I can't get to work. But some of you are very comfortable with them. I'll be reading from the New International Version, and I'm just going to read beginning at verse 42 of Acts chapter 2. How does a church continue in God's will and God's health? They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily who were being saved. Praise God. Father, I just ask that you help me with your Holy Spirit. Share in these next few minutes something that you've been dealing with me about for weeks. So, Holy Spirit, I surrender now this presentation, this preaching, this proclamation to you. Touch the hearts where the need is. Celebrate with us the great record and birthday anniversary of this church. Continue to bless, I ask in Jesus' name. Thank you for doing it, Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. All right, let me take care of a little issue, because church leaders and theologians have argued about the middle of this passage for decades. Some have said it's like a commune life where everybody just owns each other's possessions. Some, when I was starting out in ministry, even said this passage was communistic. And in the Cold War, you couldn't insult a passage with any greater statement than that. Neither of those is what Luke was talking about. Luke was saying that in a spirit-filled, healthy, living Christian life, we come to each other's aid when it is necessary. We have seen that several times in Peninsula, Florida, three times in my superintendency. We've been devastated by killer hurricanes, far beyond our ability to rebuild. But Christians and districts and churches across America have rallied to our need, and money we did not have, construction supplies that we did not have, carpenters, electricians, cement workers, plumbers, and volunteers who didn't know a hammer from a hatchet, we did not have, but they came and they built for us. They repaired for us. They paid for us. We had their resources in common. Today in our fellowship, we have what we call the Convoy of Hope. The Convoy of Hope beats the U.S. government to a disaster site every time. As a matter of fact, amen. I was in a panel truck packed with supplies and water and medicine, driving across I-10 to West Florida to Panama City 2 years ago after that hurricane blew in and devastated that entire area. We drove up to the district office, and the FEMA agent was standing on the front porch of the district office. This is what he said: "Where is Convoy of Hope going to set up? That's where we want to set up." It thrills my heart that the kingdom gets there first, amen, and that the world knows about it. That's what Luke was referring to. Scriptural evidence is abundant, but you'll remember that there was a horrible famine in Jerusalem about 25 years after the ascension and after the day of Pentecost. Many of the brothers and sisters in Jerusalem were literally starving to death. The newest church in Antioch heard of their need and took an offering and sent it by Barnabas back down to Jerusalem to relieve the need of the church there. Luke was saying, we all have our resources. He was not saying, put them into one checking account or one operational account. He was saying, when your brother or your sister has need, be generous with them. Buy them some chairs. Amen. Because they couldn't afford chairs. But you, led by the Holy Spirit, God bless you, Susan, you made your resources common, unified to the church. So if there are any leftists in the building worried about communism, get over yourself. That is not what Luke was talking about. Anytime any of our churches have a need, and boy, have we been through a year. Remember March when they said if we would go inside and stay there for 2 weeks, this would all be over? They lied to us. We're still working this out. But there were churches that had needs. And because we had a reserve at the district, we were able to commonly share with them. Let me tell you, Luke did not make a mistake. Some of the interpretations have been a little weird, along with a lot of other scriptures, Pastor Bill. Praise God. Anyway, I won't go there. That's too strange. But the thing is that a healthy church will be a church that not only loves its brothers and sisters, but helps its brothers and sisters. Anytime a church has a need in our district, I know there are certain people I can call, and they will say, yes, Terry, we will give this amount or that amount. And to this day, I have not seen the children of our Father begging or hungry without relief. I want you to know today, a healthy church is a church of unity, not just when things are good, but also when things are needy. Because who should be first on the scene? It should be the brothers and sisters of the house of God. It should be those who love each other in the family. So a healthy church is a church that is unified. Boy, you got that right up, didn't you? Praise the Lord. Of course, you know, with Pentecostals around, you need to get the offering secure as soon as possible. Hallelujah. Thank you for laughing, Susan. Amen. You know, you gave this morning because you want people to hear the gospel around the world. And you want people to have the opportunity to know Jesus around the world. That's what Luke was talking about. The second sort of unintended factor here is that the church was born in the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you, if your church does not allow the movement of the Holy Spirit, there's something wrong with your spiritual help. This morning, God spoke to us through His Holy Spirit gift, and that empowers us as a real Christian church. And I'll tell you, I'll bet 30 years ago there were a few messages in tongues, and there were a few problems because the devil hates a new church, but God loves a new church, and He will supply for that church. So here we are, all these years later, 3 decades, and the devil hasn't won yet. And, amen. He never will win. God will always win through the presence and power of His Holy Spirit. Powerful birth, generosity, and loving help for one another are traits of a healthy Christian church. Let's go back to the very first verse that we read, verse 42. And I want to quickly, everybody say quickly. Amen. I love the family. Praise the Lord. I'm the son, grandson, and great-great-grandson of preachers. And one of the things my grandfather taught me is when there's food in the foyer, don't try to preach long. Amen. Amen. Is it a chicken dinner? Hallelujah. How did I know? It's the bird that saved the minister. And the ministers saved the ministry. Hallelujah. Never doubt a preacher's belt is nothing more than a leather fence around a chicken graveyard. That's all a preacher's belt. I'll give you a minute. Amen. So I'm not going to preach long. Everybody say, thank you, Terry. Thank you, Terry. As a matter of fact, I'm already about half through. Say, thank God. Oh, come on, you hypocrites. I know you're hungry. Hallelujah. Verse 42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. The first thing we need to do is bring our existence into alignment with what God did when He transferred from the temple sacrificial system to redemption and salvation through the name and blood of Jesus Christ. Why did not Luke say, as was common in that time, as was exclusive in time, why did not he say, and they taught the law of Moses? That was the scripture they had. And that's what they looked at. That's what they stood upon. But Luke said they continued in the apostles' teaching because the apostles had stopped preaching the law because Jesus had fulfilled the law. The law no longer had dominion over us as fallen human beings. The law and its judgment was not the rule of the church. The freedom of Jesus Christ had become the freedom of the church and the liberty of the saints. That was why they listened to the teachings of the apostles. The apostles were not saying, you're sinners, and once a year you've got to come to church and have a sacrifice. The apostles were saying, Jesus is with us today, and you can be in his presence right now. Hallelujah. I want you, amen, praise the Lord. I want you to know that what we have, Moses wanted, what we have, Abraham wanted a daily opportunity to walk with Jesus Christ. You get that vertical relationship correct, and the rest of your church life will be healthy. You get that vertical relationship damaged or destroyed, and the rest of your church will be sick. But I want you to know today, Jesus is with us. And we are still preaching the Apostles' Creed, the Apostles' teaching, because we want you to know that you can have a personal, constant relationship with Jesus Christ. We don't come to this church to get into the presence of God, even though we enter his presence when we come here. We come here to report what we've experienced all week long in the presence of God. Hallelujah. The devil is busy all week. Amen. That's why the Holy Spirit is working all the time. He doesn't say, well, just wait for Sunday. Something good's going to happen. No. He will answer your call in a second. Answer your prayer in an eternal moment. Make that vertical relationship, that knowledge of Jesus constantly with us, sure and steadfast. Secondly, and fellowship. That's what we're about to do when we open up those asbestos containers. Hallelujah. We're going to enjoy fellowship. Well, as much as we can right now in this circumstance. After the power of your vertical relationship, you must have the unity of your horizontal relationship. I have a little nephew, Cole. He's my wife's youngest sister's little boy. And a few years ago, I was teaching him about praying, especially at night, you know, the end of the day prayer just before you go to bed. And we prayed together, and we were visiting over at their house, and we were going to leave after we put him to bed. And so I started to get up, and he grabbed my shirt, and he said, Uncle Terry, don't go. I said, Cole, I have to go. And anyway, we've prayed. Jesus is with you. He said, I know. Jesus is here in spirit, but I need somebody in presence. I need somebody that I can see that's here. Sometimes God uses our horizontal fellowship to affirm our vertical fellowship. Everyone in this room is valuable to every other one in this room. Hallelujah. When we were talking about responding to need just a few moments ago, the first call I always make is to God. I get on my knees or I get in my car. I've prayed a lot of powerful prayers looking down I-95 and across I-4 and up and down I-75. Oh God, we've got to have help and we've got to have it right now. Almost every time, names will start to come to my mind. And I know that's the Lord saying, call them. Because I not only need the blessings of eternity, I need some blessings of this time and of this place. I need some checks. I need some cash. I need something that only my horizontal fellowship can provide. This day, on your 30th anniversary, you are living proof that God still answers prayer. You are living proof that this church is healthy. You are living proof that God is still doing good. Why? Well, let's continue to read the verse. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread. There are two ways we can interpret this phrase. Firstly, it is eating. It's kind of obvious, right? My dad used to say, never overlook the obvious. Don't get so far into the weeds that you forget what it says. The breaking of bread. But what was the last thing Jesus did with the apostles just a few hours before he was arrested? They were eating Middle Eastern style. There were vegetables and a little bit of hummus and tabbouleh all over the table. A little bit of meat maybe right in the middle, but each apostle had a little round pita loaf, pita bread. And Jesus held that up and he tore it. And he said, as often as you do this, remember me. For us, as often as we eat together or eat at all, we can be reminded that Jesus is with us. And sometimes, I just stop there for a moment. I was taught to pray before the meal. If you were taught to pray in the middle or at the end, I have no qualm with that. I have no argument with that. But the reason now, yea, verily, these later years in life and ministry, that I like to pray at the beginning of the meal is because of this very reminder. I open up the lid on that. Or that Big Mac. But I take a minute. Say, Jesus, I thank you for this food. But more than that, I thank you for the reminder of the promise that you are always with me. You are always here. Pastor Calvin mentioned my wife, my mate of 50 years. The Lord called her home. As a matter of fact, Tuesday is the 9th of February. She went to glory the 9th of February last year, first anniversary. So that's a little bit on my mind and on my heart. She had a long bout with cancer over a year. She actually died of kidney failure as a result of the chemotherapy. But about 4 months into her journey, the Lord spoke to her and said, I want you to take communion every morning. And until she was too weak to do it, we took communion first thing every morning. I slept in her hospital room. I stayed with her constantly. At the end, she was in the hospital for 18 days. She was stabilized. We went home for about a week, but then she collapsed again, and I had to get her back to the emergency room, and then 8 days after that, she went to be with the Lord. Every morning, we broke that bread and said, thank you, Jesus, that you are here. We need you. We want you. Thank you that you are here. Now, I'm not trying to pull your heartstrings. What I'm trying to communicate is that a healthy church in its communion process always acknowledges the presence of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. It's not just bread, and in our case, juice. It is always the presence of the Lord. I do not understand Christian churches that argue that there should be no living presence of God in our services. That is all symbolic, and people who seek that are just emotional. Well, I don't think they've eaten with Jesus lately. Because if you eat with Jesus regularly, you know he's in this service. You know he's in this place. You know he's with you when you have a need. And they broke bread. They took communion. Now, I'm not going to get all dramatic and go down some drama road, but I can imagine that there was more than once when Peter and Mark and John picked up a piece of pita bread and tore it and broke into tears. You remember when he did that just before he was arrested? And they would all say yes. And what did he say to us? When you eat, remember me. Thank God he was here 30 years ago. But thank God more that he's here right now. Hallelujah. I thank the Lord for the history. But I am so grateful for the moment. Now I've got to hurry. Say amen. I've already broken my promise to you, haven't I? I'm sorry. Prayer. The next phrase, the breaking of bread and prayer. How many of you really love someone in your life? Of course. It's a joy to talk to them, right? Unless you're arguing, then that's another sermon. But it's just a joy to talk to them. Prayer, in its purest form, is conversation with God. He said, not only do I want you to remember that I'm in heaven, and remember that I'm in your fellowship, and remember that I told you to remember me, I want you to talk to me. I want you to have fresh conversation with me. And when we do that, beloved, the Holy Spirit makes his presence so precious to us. Did you enjoy the worship this morning? I did. The Holy Spirit is blowing. You ever been around a fresh wind? Amen. You better be careful because it's powerful. It's got authority. It will help you get along. I want you to know today, that conversation, that response of the Holy Spirit takes us to a place that blows us through our problems, blows us along our way, and blows us to victory in the name of Jesus Christ. Those things are the marks of healthy churches. Pastor mentioned we have 350 churches in our district. Some of them are not healthy. But I've seen God heal unhealthy churches. Was never through doctrine, even though we have a great doctrine. Was never through our bylaws and constitution, though we have great documents. It was not even through our practice. It was always through the Spirit. When God gets ready to keep something healthy or make something healthy, he uses his Holy Spirit. Got problems today? Invite the Holy Spirit into what you are facing and then listen to the wind. Hallelujah. The same wind of the upper room can be the wind of your inner heart and inner soul. That's what prayer is all about. It releases the vertical, the horizontal, and the fellowship into our healthy church. And the product of all of that is the very last sentence of this passage. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Acts 2 opens with a massive salvation experience. 3,000 added to the church at the end of Peter's sermon. A massive conversion experience. But we don't hear about them ever again. Through the rest of the book of Acts, are through Paul's epistles, are John's, are Peter's two letters. No one refers to that crowd again. The reference is to those who were added to the church day by day, week by week, moving forward. We thank God for the revival explosions, but it's the steady, healthy increase of people added to the church that makes the long-term difference. That's why I celebrate you, one of the original ones, still here. And if only the original ones were still here, be a small crowd. Amen. Aren't you glad for those that have been added along the way? I am. Every year at District Council, we ordain new ministers. And it's been said to me more than once, why are you ordaining new preachers? We got enough. No, we don't. Because the Lord is opening new doors. The Lord is opening new places. The Lord is opening new opportunity. And if we have to go back to 1929 when this district was founded and find somebody we can use, we are in big time trouble. But there's been a few since then. Hallelujah. Just before the ordination service, I always say to our ordinees, you are proof that God has a future for Peninsula, Florida. Even if it's just to be a newly ordained minister at the rapture, he has a plan for tomorrow. Folks, the final part of the plan for a healthy church is steady, regular growth. That is what the Lord wants in his churches. This day, you have affirmed your pastor and his dear wife. I want to join that affirmation because all of the things we have talked about in this discussion, they show in real life. And we ought to commemorate that, and we ought to honor that at this moment. So Pastor Calvin and First Lady Christy, would you please come? Paparazzi. I think they want Christy's picture, the pretty one, amen. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for sticking it out. Not every day has been as joyous as this day, but every day has been as victorious as this day because God never fails. Sometimes his servants don't last, but God never fails. You have been faithful. You are lasting. And you stand at the entrance of a future that is powerful in the name of Jesus. So, in commemoration of this moment, and on behalf of the executives and presbyters and pastors and people of the Peninsula Florida District Council of the Assemblies of God, I offer you this token as a memento of our love and appreciation for you. Thank you for all you have done. And should Jesus tarry, may there be 30 years more of victory and advance in Jesus' name. God bless you. Amen. Praise God. Pastor, I'll just hand this to you.
Thank you, Brother Terry. Well, what a day. What a journey. And we're still in a journey. We haven't reached a destination. Of course, our ultimate destination is heaven, but we're going to get there together. Thank you for being here. Thank you for those that came just for this special day. We love you. We appreciate each and every one of you. And we do have lunch for you, and we want you to get that on your way out, and you enjoy that in the privacy of your own home or wherever you choose to do that. We're gonna try to get Pastor Terry out to maybe one of the cakes. I said, don't cut all the cakes, because they say, happy 30th anniversary. We might be able to stand by one of those cakes and get one more photo. But thank you. I want to ask you to stand. Father, what can we say? What can we say? But thank you. Thank you. Your faithfulness, Lord. We can only celebrate because of you. And we are grateful for your faithfulness to this church. And for what is yet ahead of us, because the best is truly still yet to come. And so we thank you for this time. We thank you for what it means to us, that we're all, this is all of us, celebrating what you have done in and through Acts 2 Worship Center. Bless us, Lord. I want to just say, bless the food. We'll pray that right now. Bless the food. Thank you that you've provided it for us. And may we continue to remember your faithfulness. Everybody in this room has a story, not just an Acts 2 Worship Center story, but a God story. A story of God's faithfulness in their lives. Let us remember this day. Let there be an altar erected in our own hearts of the faithfulness of our God, that we can visit often and be reminded of your goodness and of your faithfulness. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. We love you.